This is our continuation of how to make an incremental or clicker game using HTML and JavaScript. So today we're going to be going over how to make your website look better and to make it look overall better so it doesn't look just like this. Add a little like CSS, which is cascading style sheets, which will improve the look of the website. Okay, so the first thing we're going to go over is how we're going to add something to like tell me what the score per second is. So in order to do that, we need to add a new paragraph element, and we'll do actually we are going to replace this because we want to make it a little bit better instead of just saying score. So do something like this: span ID equals score 0 and the span, and then put whatever your currency in your game is. Then we'll start another one. And the ID for this one will be score per second, which will be 0. And then end it with salsa, or whatever your currency is, per second. Okay, let's save that and see what it looks like. And as you see, you're getting the same exact thing as before. Okay. Now, we need to add something, add a new function. This is going to be called function update score per second. And what this is going to do is going to take all this, all the scores per second, add them together, and then re-update the ID. So in order to do that, we'll do score per second equals cursors plus grandma's times 5. And then we're going to get the score per second ID and set its inner HTML to score per second. As you can see, if we get it, and it does look like we do have an error. Oh, yes. Okay, so once we're done with that, we need to go at the end of every like by function. So if you have more than the two, like by curse by grandma, let's say you have more than these two, you need to put this function update score per second at the end of every single one. Now, this function doesn't have any arguments, which is totally fine. All functions do not have to have arguments, they just execute this. This is basically, we're basically replacing this with this, so it makes it a little bit easier to do, so we don't have to keep on rewriting it. So, you see, it'll tell us we're getting 4 salsa per second. So, that's everything we need to do with JS so far, but before we end, let's set the title. So, in most clicker games, you usually have a title that tells you how many salsa or what your currency is in the title of the page, so like right here. So we're going to do that. We're going to go document.title equals score plus whatever your currency is, and then your game name. So if we keep on doing this, it will update about every so second if you wanted to update more often. Basically, whenever you're getting income, it is also updating. Okay, so that's everything we want to do in JavaScript. Now I'm going to teach you what CSS is. Okay, so for CSS, what we need to do is we need to add a special tag in the head element, which is called the style tag. So what you need to do is you need to add the style tag, and this will allow us to add styles to the website. It is in the head tag, that's usually where they go. So let me show you an example one. So what you have to do is you have to put what you want to affect. We want to affect all span elements. And then you put a curly bracket at the end. So you put whatever you want to affect. So if you wanted to affect ID score, if you wanted to do something with the score, you only wanted to affect score, you would do that. If you only want to affect it a span, all spans, you can do that. So what it does is you can do something like color red. Color affects the font color. And when you look at that, it is now red. This is also not red because that is also a span. Or I can can do background color. And also made it red, and you can see where all the spans are at. But if I only wanted an effect, let's say score, I could put hashtag score because that shows that I am using the ID, then score. And you see, it'll do that. But if I just had score, it wouldn't work. So here you can add like little cool, make your website look a little bit different than the basic website. So we'll remove that, so it should look like this. First thing we're going to do is we're going to add some divs. So div class equals section left. And then you want to close it after this. So what a div is, it basically just groups a bunch of elements together so that you can like do a lot of things to these elements. So for this case, we're going to add a dot. So because it's a class, we have to put a dot because we want to affect all of objects with the class section left. So classes are like basically identifier. It's like an actual real life class. So if you have a class for philosophy, you can set philosophy, all classes in philosophy have a blue room. So that would be like an example. So do dot, section left, curly bracket, and then end it. So we're going to do something called floating, and we're going to float it to the left. This means it's going to go, basically it's going to float or just go to the left. You see nothing should change. Okay, then let's add actually you need to remove this and only in case of this stuff right here. Then we're going to create another div. Div class equals section left. That'll encase all your shop buttons. Wait, section right, sorry. In this case, we want to do section right, float right. And again, for CSS, like in HTML, the tabs don't matter. You can do this if you wanted to, have them all flat. It doesn't matter. Do whatever you want. As you can see, refresh, this stuff is on the left, and this stuff is on the right, which is good. Okay. Now, we only want section left. We want section left to take the majority of the screen. Right now, they're equal. They're 50-50. This is taking 50% of the screen. This is taking 50% of the screen. So we want more, right? So we were going to do width 80%. Yeah, you can set width properties in the section left. So now, this should take 80% of the screen, which means we need to set this to only 20% to make it equal 100% of the screen. Oops. As you can see, it has worked. Okay, so since now we have it setting to having a left side and a right side align, we need to do something with the score. We're going to make another div. We're going to say div class score container. And then you're going to close it after you've encased everything from the score. Since this contains all the score stuff. So, let's make a new class, score container. And we're just going to leave it at that. And then, as you see, we reload. These are now conjoined, which is good. That's what we want. So, next what we're going to do is we're going to create a BR. So, BR, what it does is it breaks the line. So, it just makes a new line. So, if I refresh, as you see, it has a new line. It's basically just an empty line. So now I want everything in here to be centered. So we'll make a center tag in between and then put everything in it. Like so. So everything is now in a center tag. And when you look at that, we now have it centered on, or in 80% of the screen. It's not going to be centered in the whole screen, it's just inside that sphere of space. It's centered relative to section left. Okay, next what we want to do, you want to create a new div, class equals clicker container, and then that's it. This is going to be for future use, but for now we don't need to worry about it. We just want to keep it a little more simple. Okay, in the score container, we can add something really cool, like a background color. Then there's this thing called RGB, which is just another way to say red or blue. It's just a fancy way to get more custom colors than the basic ones. New RGB, and then parentheses, 238. So this is how much red the color is, how much green the color is, how much blue the color is. RGB. A little funny. And then you can leave it at that. You'll get something like that. But if you want to add like an opacity effect, you can put 0.6, which will get the same effect. Okay. Which makes it like a little bit clearer so you can see somewhat through it. So if you have an image behind it, you can do that. Okay, then we'll do a width of 50% since we do not want the whole thing taking up the whole screen. As you can see, no longer does that. Okay, next we're going to add padding, which makes the gap, you see the gap between the text and the edge of the thing, you see it gets bigger. That way it looks a little bit bigger on the top and bottom sides. Border, and then we're going to set the border radius property to 10 pixels. This is going to give it a rounded border, as you can see, a rounded, little rounded border right there. You can make it even more round by increasing it, like 200 pixels. You see, it gets really round, but we're going to keep it at 10 because I don't want it super round, but I don't. You can always change it if you want to customize it. All these options that I'm showing you are stuff I want to make my website look like. You can change them to your liking, so you can change background color, just mess around with it. Okay, then we'll change the font size to 24 pixels. You can see. But the text kind of looks a little bland, so we could do something called font weight and then set it to bold. You can see. So, this gives it like a background color. This gives it a defined width, so it doesn't take up the whole width, it just takes up that thing, kind of makes it, doesn't really change anything but the background. This makes it bigger on the top and bottom, more margins from the text to the edge. This gives it rounded corners, this increases the font size, and this makes the font text bold. So then, next thing we need to do is we need to edit the clicker container. I'm going to add a gap in between all those. So, clicker container image. We're going to add one thing, which is position relative, which isn't really going to affect anything at the current moment, but it makes it everything that's inside the image relative to the image for positioning reasons. You don't need to worry about it right now. Okay, and then you can leave it out if you want to. You don't have to have it. And then we're going to have a transition event. This is all going to make sense, actually. No, we won't have that just yet. Okay. Next, we can add a thing called hover. So what a hover does is what happens to the image once you hover over it. So this only happens when you hover over a thing. In order to get that, you have to add semicolon and then hover. And then for this case, we're going to set transform scale 1.10. See? It grows. Okay, let's go back and let's add it so when we click it, something changes to kind of give it more of a life. So you go to click our container and then image. And then this time, you're going to do active, and then you're going to do another transform. Since I wanted to make it look like it gets smaller as you click it, you can make it bigger, but what I do, I'll do 0.0099. And do something like that. As you can see. Now, it is making it look like I'm clicking it. The problem is now, is it's a little abrupt. You see, it just does it instantly. We want it to be more gradual. In order to do that, we need to make a transition event. And in this transition event, we want to do all, which means all effects like scale, background color, everything. Anything that changes is going to have a 0.2 second ease and out, which makes it gradual, kind of. You can see? And now, gradually does it. Taking on the clicking, it's not abrupt, and that's what we are looking for. Okay. Now, another thing we need to do is right now the buttons. Buttons do not look very good, so let's fix that. So scroll down to your little section right here, and you can delete everything in it. Don't worry, we're going to add a reback. So make a table. So what a table is basically this. You have a table rows, which are your little rows, and then you have your table columns, which are basically TDs. So you define the table rows first, and then you define how many TDs are in that row. So like this. So for example, let's set the class of this table to be shop button, and then on click equals by cursor. And then close it. Okay, next we're going to create a table row and then end that table row. So we're now in this table row, and then right now we need to add table columns to define what it's going to look like. So for now, we're going to do td id equals image. And have an image, src images slash cursor. For me, it's going to png. So before we go on further, you do need to get images. My images are cursor, grandma, oven. So you just need to have your images in your image folder before you continue, and make sure you know the name and then what the extension is. Okay, next we're going to have ID equal name and cost. So this is where the name and the cost of the item or the building is going to be. And then we're going to have a paragraph element, and we're going to name it the cursor. Then we're going to have a span element, which is cursor cost, which is going to be 15. And then put your currency name, and then there you go. Oh, P. Okay. Then after this table column, we're going to do another one, TD, ID equals amount. And then span ID equals cursors, and then 0 slash span slash D. And you should see, if we load up the page again, it should look something like this. Now if I click it, as you can see, it still increases, but it looks terrible. Okay, so your next thing you want to do is you want to add a new style, so class shop button. Okay, we're going to set the background color to something fancy. I don't know, B5. This is a hex code. It's 6 digits or letters, and then it's led by a hashtag. You don't have to have the hashtag. It'll still work, as you can see, but I like putting the hashtag because that's where you see where you find it. It really doesn't matter if you put the hashtag there for a hex code. Okay, we're going to add another transition event. All 0.2 seconds, ease in and out. Because we're going to be changing the background when they hover over it, and we want it to be more gradual. So we're going to set the border radius to 10 pixels, give it a more rounded corners. We're going to set the width to 100% of the right section. And then margin, 10 pixels, 0 pixels, 10 pixels, 0 pixels. So For this is going to set the margins, how far it is away from the edge of the div. So like, for an example, so let's say this is our box, and this is our bigger box. The space between the edges, like right here. So like this gap right here, this gap right here, this gap right here is the margins. Now, when we're setting it this way, 10 pixels, 0 pixels, 10 pixels, 0 pixels, this is the top margin, right margin, bottom margin, left margin. So it's like a clock going clockwise. And this looks like this, which we need to fix the image is what we need to fix. But for now, we're going to add a shop button hover effect, and all we're going to do is change the background color. Hashtag C7, C7, C7. And then we're going to set the transition all 0.2 seconds ease in and out. As you can see, slowly changes the background, set it in an abrupt motion. So you have to have this here to make it change to this color, and then this to change back. So that way it's eased in and out when you change your color from hovering and unhovering. Okay, since we have that, we need to edit the shop button image to make it a little bit smaller. So in order to do that, we need to do shop button, and then we're going to go to the second element, image. So what it does is it's looking for a shop button. Okay, I found that, and then it's going to go for the first image element. So then it's going to go for the image elements. Now it only targets the image elements inside of the shop button. So if I put some random image here with the ID image, it won't affect it because it's not in the shop button class. Or it's not nested into it. Okay, so we're going to set the width to 25%, and that should actually not fix it yet, because we're setting the column that holds it, not the actual image itself. So we need to do that. We need to do shop button image, which is the element, since it doesn't have a dot or a hashtag in front of it. Height 64 pixels, and then width 64 pixels. And would you look at that? We now have our cursor. It looks nice, and it's nice, cool. Okay, now we're going to go back into the shop button class. Hashtag name and cost, and then the P elements, and then we're going to set margin 0 pixels, and then width 60%. So what this is doing is going into the shop button class, and then going into the name and cost row or the ID, and then it's targeting the paragraph elements in there. So it's only targeting these paragraph elements. So if I added these anywhere else, it wouldn't affect them. Now we're going to do shop button hashtag name and cost P semicolon first of type. So what this is doing, this is going to get the very first paragraph element that matches these credentials. So it won't affect this one, it will affect this one. So this one right here, the one that doesn't have the, it affects both of these, but the one with the first of type is only going to affect the cursor one right here. So we're going to set the font size to 24 pixels. And then we're going to set the... Yep, that's it, actually. As you can see, it changed the icon or the name of the theme to make it bigger than this, than the theme below it. Okay, then we're going to add shop button hashtag amount. We're going to make this a really big one, so we're going to do font size 48 pixels, color, hashtag 59, 59, 59, font family, this sets what the font you want it to be, so you can do Times New Roman, Comic Sans, but in this case we're going to do Roboto, and the width is going to be set to 15%. As you can see, this sets it to a really big zero, which is kind of what we want. can see still works. Okay. Now, to show you how to duplicate this, all you have to do is copy by grandma and just change all the things again. So grandma, it cost 100 salsa and grandma's. Oops, it is JPEG for me on this file. So you can do, you can click. I'm using an auto clicker. And we have a problem. So, here we go. Grandma costs. That should fix it. There we go. So make sure you're changing everything and not keeping stuff at the cursors. So let's add one more building. So let's do var oven cost equals 1,000, and var ovens equals 0. So let's just copy this by grandma to by oven. And then oven cost. Set it to ovens. And then, same thing for this. All you need to do is copy. Paste by oven. And just slowly change everything. As you can see. Let me just cheat really quick at the game. If you ever want to give yourself a lot of things, all you have to do is go to console and just set score equal to that. It'll update it for you. Then you can add that into your game. And then, of course, we forgot to do this plus ovens times, let's do 70. And then you just need to add this. Now add it to your score. So now since that entire thing's added, we only need to add one more thing, and that is to, the common problem is that when you're buying a lot of these, it will do something like that where it grabs. We want to prevent that, so add a unselectable class to your styles, and in it, we can do user select none. That's all you need to do. And of course, you need to add it to the unselectable class, to anything you don't want to be selected. So all you have to do is add a space in the class, and then unselectable. So I'm going to add it to my shop buttons and everything. You see, you can no longer grab it, but if you're not using a Chromium browser, what you can do is you can add this. This is more cross-browser functionality for, like, I think this is Safari and Firefox, and this is like old Internet Explorer or old Edge, I think. Okay, so that should be everything, but I forgot to add this is the footer. We want to add a quick footer, so add at the end of the section left, so after the center tags, add class equals section footer. And then H5, salsa, clicker, or whatever you want your footer to say. And that. And then go up here, and then let's add a new class, section footer. And just set it to margin top 20%. So that way it's a little bit lower on the screen. As you can see, we now have a really good, nice looking website, and it's totally expandable. All you have to do is keep on copying these and then copy the functions and make sure to set these variables. So yeah, that's it. So next tutorial we're going to be doing is we're going to make it so this actually saves, so it's not resetting every time you refresh, and it saves it in your cookies. Right now we don't have any, but so next tutorial we're going over how to save and load it, so that way it is, you can use it more professional. It's just not all one time thing. You close, oh look, you lost all your stuff. So thank you for watching, and until next time.